stumble out of bed and I stumble to the kitchen. Pour myself a cup of ambition and yawn and stretch and try to come to life. Jump in the shower and the blood starts pumping. Out on the streets the traffic starts jumping with folks like me on the job from 9 to 5. Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living. Barely getting by, it's all taking and no giving. They just use your mind and they never give you credit. It's enough to drive you crazy if you let it. 9 to 5, for service and devotion. You would think that I would deserve a fair promotion.
Good morning. We are concluding our Summer Playlist Worship Series today with this great song from Dolly Parton, 9 to 5. It's a fitting song for Labor Day weekend, isn't it? Well, first, will you pray with me? Good and gracious God, open our hearts and our minds to your word for us today. Speak to me, through me, and perhaps also in spite of me, that the words that are spoken and the words that are heard may be completely from you. Amen. Well, it's no wonder that Dolly Parton's song became so popular, sitting at the top of 3 different Billboard charts and earning an Oscar nomination. It's a song that's relatable to so many people, isn't it? As one writer said, it's simultaneously a song of angry complaint and immense good cheer. The song starts with a healthy bit of pride as she pours herself a cup of ambition. It expresses grievances that many people share as she laments working all day and barely getting by. There's acknowledgement of concerns about class conflict and inequality in the workplace, just a step on the boss man's ladder, she says, and it ultimately leaves us feeling supported by others who are in the same boat, giving this sense of collective power. The song, 9 to 5, and the 1980 movie by the same title for which it was written, lifted up concerns of workers, and specifically of women in the workplace. The movie was actually inspired by an organization called 9 to 5 that formed as a response to women who were frustrated by the way they were treated and the way their work was ignored in their workplaces. Jane Fonda heard their story, and the movie 9 to 5 was born, starring Jane Fonda, Lily Tomlin, and Dolly Parton as 3 fed-up working women. Many of their workplace frustrations are heard in the song. About a workplace that's all taking and no giving, that uses your mind but gives you no credit, that shatters your dreams and won't let you move ahead, where you're just playing the game of the rich, she says. You know, concerns about the workplace and working conditions are also what led to the beginnings of Labor Day in the late 1800s. At the height of the Industrial Revolution, when many people, including children, worked 12-hour days, 7-day weeks in mills, factories, mines, just to scrape by. Concerns about harsh and unsafe working conditions led to strikes and rallies and riots, which eventually led to the working person's holiday of Labor Day, first in cities around the country and finally nationwide. And Labor Day sought to recognize the contributions workers made to America's strength, prosperity, and well-being. This is something that most of us can relate to, that work matters. And then in the midst of all this work and labor come the words of Jesus that we just heard, offering a different message. Come to me, all you who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, he says, and I will give you rest. Now, this is certainly something that most of us would like to grab onto, especially if we're physically and emotionally exhausted from working 9 to 5 or 7 to 7, or in the case of home responsibilities, 24/7 sometimes. Maybe Jesus is telling us about the better life that the song refers to. I will give you rest. But what does that rest really mean? Does it mean we can all take a break and put our feet up? No more frustrations or exhaustions? I can get on board with that. That's not quite what he means, though. Jesus isn't saying we won't have to work. In fact, the Bible has plenty to say about the importance of work and labor. It starts all the way back in Genesis 2 when God places the human in the garden to till it and take care of it. In other words, to work. And then in Proverbs 14:23, we hear that in all toil there is profit. Work is good. And then in 2 Thessalonians 3, it warns against idleness, saying, we hear that some of you are living irresponsibly, mere busybodies, not doing any work. We command and exhort you to do your work quietly and to earn your living. And in Psalm 90, we hear, let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and prosper for us the work of our hands. It's a prayer for the work we do to matter. Prosper the work of our hands. Our faith tells us that work is important. So even as Jesus offers us rest, an easy yoke, a light burden, he's not necessarily offering us an easy life free of work. At least not in the sense that the world talks about easy. When Jesus invites us to take up his yoke and to find rest, he doesn't mean that nothing will ever be hard. He doesn't mean that we won't have to put in effort or struggle through things. He doesn't mean that we won't sometimes be busy and pulled in a lot of directions. Our jobs and our families and the other parts of our lives will likely still leave us exhausted at times. But Jesus does offer us an alternative to the busyness and the striving of the world around us, a better life. Now, that's partially because our faith calls us to rest alongside the work. The idea of Sabbath and rest are talked about over and over in the scripture. There's way too much to unpack now. That's a sermon for another time. But Sabbath calls us to move away from constant busyness, to stop the competition of trying to do the most and be the busiest. Sabbath recognizes that while there are a lot of things that we must do and a lot of things that we should do, there are also probably things in our lives that we could let go of, that we could place on the back burner, that we could surrender in favor of a less busy life. Sabbath tells us that our life's worth is not defined by how much we can do, or by how far up the ladder we can climb, or by how respected we are. So our faith tells us that work and rest are both important and that they should be held in balance. But our faith also tells us something about what our work should be. And this is a big part of the yoke that Jesus refers to. As you may know, a yoke in farming is a wooden frame that controls animals at work. In the Old Testament, the metaphor of a yoke is used for obedience and service. And then Jesus here says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. And he's telling us to take up his way of life, to learn his ways and to let those control our lives in the same way a yoke controls what an animal does or doesn't do, tells them which direction to go. In the broadest sense, this is our work as people of God, to follow in the way of Jesus and to shape our lives on loving God and loving others. Now, the specifics of how we do that work will be different for each one of us. Some of us work in various fields outside the home. Some of us do the important work of raising children and caring for our family. Some of us do a job that isn't a career or a long-term goal, but it's what we do right now. Some of us are students. Some of us volunteer with community organizations. Hopefully, all of us do the work of worship and discipleship and serving in our church. Many of us do a lot of those things in combination. But no matter what it is that we do, it should be shaped by the larger work of faith, of loving God and loving others. I think we often place work and idleness as opposites, working hard versus being lazy, and idleness and laziness, they are not referred to fondly in the Bible. Christian tradition talks about the seven deadly sins, which can be traced back to the early centuries of the Christian church, and one of those sins is sloth, which means laziness. I know that's what you're all going to think of anyway, so there's your sloth. Sloth means laziness, but what's interesting is that the opposite of laziness in this sense isn't necessarily work. Sloth can be described as a laziness surrounding love or an avoidance of love. It reflects a lack of care, a lack of love that can be seen through laziness, or it can be seen through a restless busyness. We can be frantically busy, running from here to there, never stopping to rest, the kind of thing our society applauds, and be struggling with the sin of sloth. Because what our faith tells us is that when we're not working for the right things, we're not working as God calls us to. When our work, whatever it is not being shaped by the work of our faith, we're missing the point. So the opposite of sloth is not work, it's good work. It's work that strives for the right things and that's motivated by the right reasons. It's about taking up the yoke of Jesus as our guide and setting aside the yoke of success, achievement, money, power, whatever it is that wants to control us, setting that aside to take up the way of Christ. It's about our work being shaped on and becoming part of God's work. I said earlier that Labor Day is rooted in a desire to acknowledge the contributions workers have made to our country, and in the same way, we should be thinking about the contributions our work makes to the kingdom of God. That means the work we do and the ways we do it should line up with the ways of Jesus. You know those people in Dolly Parton's song who use others to get ahead, who disregard the needs and the contributions of the people around them, the boss man? That shouldn't be us if we're following in the way of Jesus. We shouldn't be working in ways that support values that contradict God's kingdom. We shouldn't be contributing to other people being treated poorly. When the world sees us at work, there should be evidence of the love of God. As Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, whatever we do should be for the glory of God. That applies to our work. Whether that's a paid job, the job of family responsibilities, or any other work that we do, all of it should tie into the work that we all have to live as God's people, to grow in love for God, and to share that love with the world. When Jesus calls us to take up his yoke, this is what he refers to. And again, that's not easy. It's not simple to do everything for the glory of God. It's easier said than done to live as God's people in the world. And yet, Jesus says his yoke is easy and his burden is light. He offers us rest from the weariness that comes from so much of our work in the world. The weariness Jesus refers to is not the kind of weariness that comes from being up all night with a sick kid, or from dealing with the stress of the important job that you're doing, because those things will unfortunately still happen. Instead, Jesus offers us rest from a sort of soul-sick weariness that comes from doing things that don't matter, that comes from being undervalued or treated poorly, that comes from doing work that goes against God's purposes for us. That's the kind of weariness Jesus is talking about, and those are the burdens that he offers to take away when we follow him. That's why he says his burden is light. This is the better life he gives to us. Jesus' yoke means that we have something to do, that we have a purpose that demands our all and summons our best. He calls us to work, but it's work that's inspired by a desire to build God's kingdom and to work toward a future in which all people experience the world as God would have it to be. This work, despite its difficulty, is work that puts the soul at ease as it frees us from the other things that try to control us. It's the kind of work that presents an alternative to the frustrations we hear in the song. It's the kind of work that pushes back on the concerns that spurred the Labor Day movement. It's work that lifts up something different from much of what our world applauds. So as we celebrate Labor Day this weekend, and as we recognize the important contributions of those who work, as we listen to a song like 9 to 5, let's also remember the better life that Jesus offers. Not in an idealistic way, but in a way that inspires us to join God's work and to work for what matters, to help other people know that work and that life too. Let's seek to let the yoke of Jesus be our guide so that we and all the world can find rest for weary souls. Let's not just think about that better life she refers to in the song, but let's really seek to make it happen for ourselves, for our communities, and for the world. Jesus says, "Come, and I will give you rest." So may we do that today and always. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, may we bring our burdens to you. May we bring you our exhaustion and our weariness and our frustrations. May we take up your yoke and follow your way of life that we may know the rest and the goodness you seek to give. And may we live and work in ways that allow others to know that rest as well. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen.